Hi, welcome to my channel, The Machine Learning Engineer. Today I'm continuing with the series of videos I'm doing about machine learning and MLOps with DataBridge. I will explain you how to do LLM Ops with DataBridge and MLflow. LLM Ops is not more than a subset of machine learning operations, and you will say that it's just, well, I will say advertisement, or I wouldn't say propaganda, but yeah, it's exactly the same that what we do with the other machine learning or deep learning models, but here is, well, with the specificities of working with LLMs, which is a kind of a little bit more complicated. But we had MLflow in this case that it will make our life very, very easy. If you are following my channel, you probably saw many videos about MLflow already, and where I explain how to work with this excellent tool, which help us to in the whole life. Machine learning life cycle. So if you are well, some of the subscribers, or you are regularly seeing the videos I'm publishing, you will see that what you are gonna see is pretty similar what I already exposed in many of the videos. If there is another series that is MLOps. And then in this series we are covering practically all the machine learning operations using MLflow, and this is again just a particular case of the what we were what we will show there in this other series. Also, just to remind you what is MLflow. MLflow is a library in Python which help. Let me rephrase this a little bit. It's a library in Python, but also you can use it. There is versions in R and also in Scala. So despite this library originally was written in Python, and first of all, it was a third-party tool which work together with the DataBridge, that I'm speaking kind of 3 years ago, and now is an integral part of DataBridge, and is already a tool that is maintained, and the roadmap is kept by DataBridge itself. So what you will see here, and again, if you saw some of the videos, you will see that we use in those videos about speaking about MLflow, how to use DataBridge MLflow as a tracking server and also artifact repository, which is one of the most common organizations or deployments that you will see in many, many companies. You had you use your workspace and the facilities and the MLflow feature that you have with your workspace, the DataBridge workspace. You will use it just to keep the experiments and all the tracking metadata, models and artifacts that you even produce with other technologies, regardless the cloud provider where that you are using. Also remind you that DataBridge integrates with the or is available in the three main cloud providers: Azure, AWS, and Google Cloud. Meaning that you may have other technology, maybe Kubernetes running in Amazon or SageMaker, and you can be well. Tracking your models and tracking everything in an MLflow capabilities or a server that is running in a DataBridge workspace. This is absolutely possible, and many places you will see that this is how they are working. For example, in one of the projects I worked before, we were doing everything in a bench in Amazon, and we were using the specifically. and only in these projects, in this team that we were working on, and many people working there with the data, with MLflow in Databricks, just to keep track of all the experiments and keeping the models there, keeping the track of everything that we were doing. And we didn't use Databricks for pipelines or to ATL, nothing, just we use it for keeping as a tracking server and as artifact repository. So this, what you are going to see, is quite common in the industry, and then, well, just is an example of how we can use it. And in this case, we are going to use an LLM, in this case with a Hugging Face transformer, something that we saw in one of the videos before, but now it's going to be an end-to-end process where we will register a model into the model registry, an LLM. We will transition, we will use the model transitioning capabilities of the model registry to do model governance, and then we will do batch inference with a model that we have registered in our model repository. So let's start. We just import the libraries we need. I'm using a computer, which is quite conventional, nothing special, even not a GPU. It's just a small cluster, single node. This means that we had the worker and the driver in the same box, and we had a runtime, a machine learning runtime, no GPU, 13.3. We had a machine learning runtime, which means that we had practically everything that we may need. That's why we didn't install here anything. So transformers, dataset from Hugging Face, all this stuff is already installed in the runtime. You don't need to install it apart. Here I just import the Hugging Face token into memory to the environmental variable HF underscore token using the dbutils. dbutils is a Databricks library. There is some classes. I will make a video only about the dbutils, which is one of the wonderful libraries that comes together with Databricks. We use the secrets class, and we get a secret that I have saved on this secret scope in Databricks. I had another video, and also some shorts in the channel. You can take a look to them, how to work with secrets in Databricks, how you can create different secret scopes, secrets, add secrets to the secret scope, integrated this with Keyvault in Azure. So if you are interested, take a look to the channel and you will get all the information necessary to work with secrets in Databricks. Here we just set up a directory, and we load the data frame. This is the Exum data frame. It's essentially a data frame from summarization. Let me check it. And yeah, it's just simply articles from BBC with a summary and with an identification. This a common data set to do to train models, just to fine-tune models for summarization. We are not going to do a fine-tuning here. We are going to just use a model, Artified Small, from Google. It's a text-to-text encoder-decoder. It's a typical encoder-decoder transformer architecture. It's not a pure encoder-decoder transformer. It has some enhancements that were introduced by Google. That is the Series T5. You have, I think, here in the documentation of Google, everything that you need to know. There is essentially some sizes, small, base, large, from 260 billion up to 11 billion, and there is also some other variants for specific purposes. we use the smart one, and then on here we just download the model we downloaded before. We had a cache in the Databricks file system, so it's gonna be quickly now. So the first time downloaded to the local file system, and then on it take it when you use the load dataset. It you had the data frame already there. Is taking the data frame from local and it's not downloading anymore from Hugging Face. Now we make a select of 10 randomly. We take 10 records and we create a pandas data frame just to visualize. We have here as well using the display. Display is another library in Databricks just to visualize data frames or tables in any format. Also, you can display other objects, and well, it's quite convenient tool to especially to visualize data frames. As you can see here, you are not losing anything. You can see the content of any column. It doesn't matter if you have here structures like very typical in Spark data frames, where you had a single column is an structure which can be a JSON file, a dictionary, a nested dictionary, nested arrays, whatever. You had here, you can here break down into any component that you had in your column. Here we just take the test subset of the data frame, and we serialize it to the dicks into this directory, into the DBFS database file system. We create a Spark data frame and we serialize in Delta format. Delta format is a proprietary format of Databricks. It's an enhanced Parquet. A nice Parquet, you want to say that, with a lot of the additional features just to speed up the process of writing and reading, and also to keep track of the changes, and many other features that are very convenient as well, that are working in top of the Parquet architecture. Also working with Arrows. And well, Databricks, you want to speed up reading from the data lake, always use the Delta format, which is again faster and well, in any case, much more convenient to use when you are working in this environment. So we write 11,000, a little bit more records to the DIX, and we just here make a display, and also well here when you make a we make a display of the data frame, then we make a display of the folder in the DIX, just like when you are working in a magic cell, like here with the admiration or with the percentage sign, you have to use this format. This is a typical Unix format, and you can use as well dbutils with the file system class and do an ls exactly the same that we are doing here, but here we had to point to this specific URI, which you replace the Databricks file system with this nomenclature, similar to what we use to point to a file in HTTP or in pointing to a database. URI is this essential URI. Now we create a pipeline with our model. It's going to be a conventional transformer pipeline, summarization pipeline with our model, which is the T5 small, some parameters, and the directory as well to do cache. We do it. It's already done, so it shouldn't take long. And now we just do some. We use the pipeline with some examples. Now what I'm gonna do here is just apply the summarizer to our sample dataset. This is a subset that we took randomly, some cells above with 10 records, and we just pass the summarizer, and after that we just create a PD data frame and just select the column summary text. Okay, we have it here. We had here just the summary produced by our T5 small. Here we are going to log the model into MLflow. For those that are not familiar with MLflow, what we are going to do here is essentially create an experiment in MLflow and log everything that is necessary to run or to load this model in another environment. And later on use it for inference. And then when you run MLflow, you can do it different ways, but the easiest is just encapsulate everything in a with block. And then here we just set up the name of the MLflow. When you are working in Databricks, you have to create an experiment with this nomenclature. The nomenclature is a slash user slash the username of that you use to log into Databricks, and then slash a name of an experiment. I had the habit to always put a run name to how to say to discriminate what to say all the different experiments. If you don't do it, the MLflow creates a random name for this experiment, and well, later on you probably don't know what really means or when it was done. But there is other ways to do it, but this way you just visually get at first sight that what when, for example, or what you were doing in that experiment, no? And then here you can say just simply save pipeline, I don't know, training, hyperparameter tuning, etc., etc. Inside the same experiment, you can have multiple runs with different purposes. So it's a good practice. It's a good practice when you get a name which specify what was done and when, and this way later on the URI here. When you look at the experiment, you can see first sight what was done with the run name. So here we just going to do pipeline serialization, for example, whatever. Pipeline summarize serialization or log. You can say log. We are not doing a fine tuning. We are not doing hyperparameter tuning. We are not doing training. Well, something that can identify that allow you to identify easily what was done in that experiment, in that run. Sorry, not that the experiment is here. Here is the run. So now we are logging the models as parameters for this run. Some attributes. These attributes are for the LLM, and this is the name of the model. Now we are going to create a list with the predictions that we did here. So the results, we are creating just a list, and here we just log the predictions into a table, and then essentially what we are doing here is imputing the list, sorry, imputing the input is the data frame, and the output is what we got here in results. Well, you will see later we are just logging here a CSV file with all the predictions. Now we here infer the signature. The signature is quite important when you are logging a model because it's telling how is the fo telling everybody how everybody who is going to use this the model later, what do you need to input the model and what you are gonna get as output of the model. And then usually you can, the easiest way to do it is just get an example of your output and use the same model to generate a prediction like you are doing here. And then on you have different model, different methods to do this. One of the methods is hanging on models class is infer signature, and then on generate signature output or predict is depending on the flavor of the library that you are using in this case is transformers. So we generate a signature output, you just take the summarizer, summarizes the pipeline, and we just pass an input, and this it will generate an output. And what is going to do the infer signature is just take note of which how it looks like, which data types have which shape have the output of your model. The same is doing here when you pass this as an input. We print out here the signature. We pass this inference configs is here a dictionary that we will pass as well to log the model. And then logging models, there is two different ways. One is using the library, the flavor of the library that you want to the flavor of the model that the model that you want to log into the model register. In this case is a transformer. There is a flavor for any library that integrates natively with the MFlow. This is Python, TensorFlow, Keras, Scikit-learn, I don't know, Scikit-time, PySpark or Emerleaf in this case, anything that is integrated. Take a look to the videos we had on the channel about MFlow. You will see how many flavors we had available there. Practically everything that you may know is available there. And it's not, you have always the possibility to use the Python model with a what is a py function. And then this py function is as a generic envelope, a generic wrapper to encapsulate any model, even a custom model, which is not is a combination for example of different technologies and encapsulated in a class. This is a custom model, and then you can log it as well with the py function. So you can log it either with the native flavor of the library that you are using, again in this case transformer, or with the generic class pyfun. In this case we are using transformers, and then to log the model you need obviously the pipeline, the path where you want to log this into the sorry, into the experiment, the tags, the config for inference, the signature of the model, and an example of the input, no? We run this, and this essentially is going to where here the experiment doesn't exist and is creating a new run. Here you see the signature and it's still working. So I used to do this as well. I used to encapsulate everything with a with block and also provide a name to this experiment. Once it's done, yes, it's done, right? Yeah, let me, yeah, exactly. You can take a look to all the metadata that your experiment return. Here you had everything you need to later on localize your experiment and everything that you log it there. You can do you can use this information, or you can even use a MFlow client to query the tracking server database. So if we go to experiments, so we will have here a new one, MLflow, that one. So if you log in here, you have the experiment BYC. Here you can take a look to the run, BYC, and also here, BYC, B1C. And here on the experiment, you have all the parameters that you log and also the artifacts, where you have the components, which are the tokenizer and the model. This is the T5, and also all the information that you need to later on load this model in any environment and do inference. Here I want to you notice some particularity. We are working in database. As you probably know, database is a distributed environment where which is this is a database is a commercial version of Hadoop. Spark is working with Hadoop and also other components. And usually this environment use a part of Python and other languages. You probably know as well that Spark is originally written down in Scala, which is a derivation of the Java. And then on here, what you see here, these files, metadata files that the MLflow are creating, is what you need to replicate this in any environment. When I say any environment, this is in a Python conventional environment. This is a distributed environment with some specific architecture, with some specific libraries, and if you just log what you have in your environment, you probably will not be able to run this in a conventional environment, for example, in your local computer, if you are able to do it. In this case, probably yes, because the model is very small. But what MFlow is doing, MFlow is had the intelligence, if you want to say that is detecting that you are in an Spark environment in the Databricks, and only will log the libraries that you need to replicate or to load this in a conventional Python environment. And it's providing here not only the ML model card with all the necessary information about your model, where it was logged, also conda YAML file to create a conda environment, a Python environment, a requirements TST to create a virtual environment in any place, a model card, what you need, all the information about the T5, and also the input example. So again, this is what we log here is ready to be redeployed in, for example, in a Docker and run it in a Kubernetes environment without any presence or Spark. Okay, let's return here. You will see now how later as well, doing this way, we can log this in a different architecture, for example, like happened here, and specify, okay, don't use this environment that was used to log the model, use the local environment. And when you in any case, when you are loading a model with MLflow, MLflow will check if your current environment is matching the environment that it has registered in the metadata of the experiment or the model registry. Okay, here we are going to load the model here. Instead to loading the model with the transformer one, we are loading the model with PyFun. Again, I told you PyFun is the generic class which allows you to load models from any technology, any library. Again, deep learning, machine learning like scikit-learn, time series forecasting, NLP like SciFi, MLlib from Spark, whatever. You can either load it with the flavor of the library, transformer in this case, or with the generic one. The generic one had the advantage, if you want to say that, that they had a few methods, but all of them are common to all the technologies. The method predict, the function predict, is common. If you load a model with PyFun, you already know that you will use predict to make a prediction. How you will do it? What you infer in the infer signature. What it was inferred here, so you will have to input a list of the strings, and you will get an output of the a list of the strings of output. What we do here with the load summarizer, we make a predict, we take our sample, which is a SPAR data frame, we transform it to pandas, and we take only the document, which is the BBC document, and we just transform the results, which is still here. We just transform the results to a pandas data frame. Here we are going to get a list of the strings. If you remember the signature, is a list of the strings, and we create with this list of strings, we create a data frame with a column generated summary. Simple, right? And now we are going to log the model into the model registry. So you cannot use some, we get this name. I already used it in a couple of times before. And then on what you see here, you cannot use some characters, special characters, so we just replace them. Here's still doing the prediction. Don't forget that we are predicting here. Well, only 10, if I don't remember, yeah, 10. Well, it's taking a while. It's already done. And now we are going to register the model in the model registry. Let's take a look at what we had on the model registry. We had already three versions of the model. In the model registry, every time that you log a model in the model registry, first of all, it checks if you are using the same name. And if you already are using the same name, it will create a new version of the model. And then now there is a feature on the model, in the model registry, that you can do kind of the model governance. You have four stages in the model. One is known, so no stage. You just register the model. You have staging, you have production, and you have archive. Archive, when you move the model to archive, you cannot use it anymore, and then you can play with the other three stages. Kind of model governance, and you can later on just expose those models that you have in production and using for inference. So what we are going to do now is just register the model. This used to take some time, so I'm going to stop now. And then when it's done, I will continue with the video. Okay, it was quickly. Now we have, you see here, we have the version 4. We can go to the registry, we refresh, and you see here, we just register a new version of our model, and the stage is known. Now we start a MLflow client. We can search in the model model registry how many models we have. We did it or no? Okay. So one second. We have here one, version 2, version 4, version 3. Exactly. By default, only give you the first three. The three more recent models. So we have the version 2, the version 4, the version 3. The version 1 is not shown. So What we are going to do here, we are going to take the version 3 that now is in production. Remember this, version 3 is in production. We load it. To load the model, we are using PyFont, load model. Here, if you look at here how we did it, instead we can point to the model info URI. This is the address in the experiment. Runs, this is the run ID, and it's on the path summarizer. Take a look how we lock the model. In the artifact path summarizer, if you look experiments. If you look at the artifacts, here you have everything under summarizer. Let's go. So now you also can load the model pointing to the model registry. Sorry, it's a little bit up. Here, exactly. And you can just take a look to here. Let's load it and then on I will show you. We load the model and then on I will show you what is that. So you can also point the model with the name of the model slash the version. So now we copy this model into another variable, a staging model, and just we do inference just to you see that is worse. You may have different, let's imagine that this model that you registered is coming from a hyperparameter tuning process, or even you are using another size. It's all perfectly possible. Is you register different models, different even different flavors with the same name, and all of them you can load it with PyFont, and all of them, if you follow the instructions, if you create the signature, you will have a method predict, and you will be able to use it exactly the same using the PyFont. We do the prediction, and now we are going to do is transition this. This is the version 3. No, what I want to do is one thing. Let me 1 second. Production. I think I lost something here. Exactly. First of all, model 3. We are going to transition these two archives to use the version 4, which is what I wanted to do. You see here, now we had all the models in archive, and the model 4, we will do it now. Model version 4, we load it. Is coming from this run ID. If you look at the experiments, is this one, the last one we run, and you can see here now the URI. We copy this in that model, we make some inference, it will be maybe it's the same, maybe something different, should be something the same. But remember that you can change here these parameters that we min length, max length, truncation, do sample, temperature, for example. You can introduce all these parameters in a new model and have different versions. All of them, all these parameters will be registered in the all this metadata will be registered here on the experiment here. And now what we are going to do is transition the model to production. Now we go to the model. Let's refresh this. You have it here, production. And now with the modeling production, we are going to load. You remember here about we load the test data set in a delta table in the file system here. We serialize it here in this directory. And now what we are gonna do is to do batch inference using the production model, the version 4. So we load the model from the prod data path. We obviously read this as a Spark data frame. You can see that is a Spark data frame. And here now with PyFarm and the Spark UDF, we are going to create a special wrapper which allows you to use with this model a Spark data frame. It's as simple as that. Which has use the flavor Spark. We use the model. This is the environment. Which environment I'm going to use? The one I'm using right now. When you specify local, you are telling to MLflow, don't use the metadata about the environment that you had in the model registry. Use what you had here in this environment. This allows you, as I told you, or gives you the flexibility to choose. Even here, you can specify your own environment. And then on MLflow, we'll check if this model can be loaded in this environment and running and run inference with that model. If something is not matching or is incompatible, it will raise an exception and it will not do inference. But you had the flexibility. You had all the information about how the model was locked. You can choose this environment. You can try just with the model, don't specify anything. It will simply try to run the model in the environment that you specify. You can do as well just actively specify use this environment, and in any case, as I said, MLflow will try to run. If something goes wrong, it will raise an exception and the model will fail. But usually MLflow tried to do the best. No, this is you remember in the environment we don't have a Spark, and obviously we had a PySpark version here. Let me probably we can show somehow here. Yeah, I can show you somehow how it works. If we go to app, we open a terminal. So if you just write Python, PySpark. Come on. Yeah, exactly. Probably it's not correctly all the PySpark. It should work. It's not. Come on. Well, I'm completely sure that we have PySpark here in this. Probably something connected with the environment that is not. Correctly instantiated, and we need to conda. Let me check. Conda is not installed. Yeah, probably I need to set up some environment variables. But what I want to tell you here in Spark, in Database, we have PySpark. This is a PySpark environment. So this is not reflected let me show you. In this model cards or Python environments, everything is just ready to be deployed in a conventional Python environment. When we specify here locally, it's just we are just telling use your environment, and well, you see that you have here some warnings and some info, but the model is going to be able to work, no? Again, if something is not suitable and is impossible to run, MLflow will get you or it will raise an exception. And now here what we are gonna do is use just proc data. Is the data frame we read here is a Spark data frame. For those that knows PySpark, is very common. We create a new column in the Spark data frame. The name is gonna be generic summary, and we use the Spark UDF function to with the column. The input of the Spark UDF function is document. What is gonna do the Spark UDF is going to apply the model. The model is what we load in the model URI format Spark. And if you remember the signature accept a string. Let me show you where it goes. Here, input string, output string. So what we're gonna do here is the Spark UDF will load the model in format Spark. In this environment, we output a string, and we will apply the model to what? To the input document. The document, as you remember, is the original BBC article, and the output is gonna be written down in a new column. That's why we are using with column method of the PySpark data frame. And then the output of applying the model to document, which is gonna do a summarization, it will be written down in summary. We just apply. It's gonna take a while as well because we are applying this to a number of you remember we had 11,000 records in this table. So I stopped after it finished. It's done. Take a look. 51 seconds. We make inference of more than 11,000 records in just 51 seconds. Don't forget that we had a really small machine, 16 gigabytes, 4 cores, so nothing. Probably even less than what you had in your at your desktop. And here you can see here this is the original data frame, the one we have here with these three columns. And now we add a new column with this generated summary, which is the one that produced to apply the model to the document column. Here we have the original one, here the summary that come in the data set itself, and this is the summary produced by our T5 model. And the last step, we just add the inference to a data frame in this part. Take a look to how we load the model. This is usually how it's done in production. When we load the data frame, just imagine that we are receiving new data. The new data is coming to somewhere else. We read it from a pandas data frame, and we just load it. So we save it in data in a folder for the inference of that how to say time slot. It can be a day, it can be a week, it can be a 15 minutes, whatever, no? So we take in this case, we take a pandas data frame. This is the new data, and we save it in a folder in the lake. We use the delta format, and we overwrite. We don't care about what was there before. And then at the time that we had the inference, so we run our model in the new data, we use the output. We have another table for the output, but in this case, what we are doing is append, not overwrite. We are appending the new inference to the existing table let me say in this folder. Okay. Well, that's all. You can see here we make a end-to-end process in how usually we do in production in a company. Obviously, there is many cases more complicated pipelines. This is quite simple, but just give you an idea how work together with TensorFlow, with an LLM, with reading data, working with Spark data frames, with Pandas data frames, with different technologies all together in a single technology like is Databricks. Together with TensorFlow, it allow you to interact with multiple technologies in a very simple way. Today we work with transformers, but what you see here is easily, very easily applicable to any other technology that integrate directly with TensorFlow, or even if you have a custom model, which is a combination of multiple models, and you just apply, you encapsulate all this complexity in a class, you can use also a custom PyFarm model and use exactly the same that you saw here. You can use this with LangChain, we can use this with LangChain, meaning that the chain can have an LLM with, can be OpenAI, can be Anthropic, can be whatever. It will give you the same interface to interact with. You just need to lock the model into the TensorFlow registry as a PyFarm, and then unload it and apply the input to the model as you see here. Also, you can apply information in batch as you saw here. Exactly the same. So far, you follow the step to serialize the model correctly in the model registry. After that, you can load the model as a PyFarm flavor and use it for inference with a Spark data frame, with a Pandas data frame, with whatever, and use everything on the same environment, which is in this case Databricks. In this case, as I explained you, quite powerful tool, very flexible, allow you to work with many technologies, and well, something that for sure you need to have in your, how to say, in your Swiss knife. A tool that you need to know, you need to know how to work with, because it will make, believe me, your life very easy at the time that you need to deploy your models into production and to establish pipelines. Because one of the advantages to work with Databricks, as is here, you are centralizing many operations. You have here access to databases, to data lakes, to multiple technologies. You can do here machine learning, you can do here ETL processes, you can interact with other technologies, and as well, other technologies can access as well to the tracking server and artifact repository that you have here in Databricks. We will see as well at some point the serving capabilities of Databricks, which will allow us, as we saw in other technologies like Vertex AI or Mazur Machine Learning Studio, it will allow us to do to expose an endpoint to serve or to be used as inference points to any model that we have in our model registry. But this is for another video. Okay, that's all. Thank you very much for watching. And again, as usually say, you like it, give me a like, subscribe to the channel if you didn't do it before, and share with your friends and colleagues if you want to help me to and help me to expand my channel in YouTube and to grow my channel in YouTube. Thank you very much. See you soon.